2010 was a challenging time for me. I had several things happen at one time that wasn't really part of my plan in my life. I had recently started back in school, waited 25 years to go back to school, so I was really excited about that and nervous about that. And shortly into my time of school, I found out that my husband was going to get deployed to Afghanistan, which I didn't anticipate and didn't know what that meant for me to continue my education, but just a challenge for me to get through that. And our son at that time was a senior in high school, so he had several events. He played football and basketball and was very active in school, and so I tried to fill that gap where my husband couldn't be there to be at all his games and support him in any way that I could. And during a game in October, fairly later in the season, he was returning a kickoff, a ball, and he just went down unexpectedly and was in pain, extreme pain. And I knew just from having other boys that it just seemed to me like it was his knee. I just knew he tore his ACL. I just had this feeling about it. So while he was recovering and going through all of that, my father was also not doing very well. And being a student, I was, my time was pretty committed to classes and meeting other needs. So during my Christmas break, I was able to go down and spend some time with him and my mom. And I knew he wasn't doing well, but I didn't realize how bad it was. So we went there, spent time with him, and he seemed to be doing better. So we left, and within a half hour, they called me to tell me he passed away. So I was able to be there for my mom, to help her through that. Then in January, my son calls me on the phone and says, "Mom, there's something wrong with our baby." He was, his wife was pregnant with our first grandchild. And we were so excited. I've been praying since she just found out that she was pregnant for this little baby. And he said, "There's something seriously wrong with the baby." And that, I think, was the point in my faith. It was really low because I was pretty mad. And I felt like, "God, I know that you're in control. I just don't understand." Of course, I was alone. There was no one home because my husband was in Afghanistan, and each time, through each situation, I was unable to reach him until hours or a day later, so I had to kind of process all of this. But I, in a way, I feel like God wanted me alone so that I could lean on him. But in spite of all of those things and them coming in such a short amount of time, I do, you know, think of what my earthly father would say. He would say, you know, "Bad things come in bunches, but good things do too." And we don't serve a mean God. We serve a God who loves us. And it's hard when you're going through those moments to feel that love. But looking back, I see his mercy for sure. And his love in spite of my childish response.
Real stories, yeah. Real stories, real hurts, real adversity, real situations, real life. And so what we can do during those times of adversity is we lean into God's promises. And that's really what this series is all about, promises. And we hope as we look at the scriptures that we find that hope, that assurance, that confidence, the strength that we find in God's promises to us in his word. So we ask ourselves, though, what happens when we take one of those scriptures, and we take those verses of scripture out of context. What happens when we read into the context what we want the verse to say, as opposed to what God intended for that verse to say? Can you see the dangers in that? Dangerous, right? It's kind of like what I experienced as a young man. But it wasn't in reading God's word. It was the dangers of misinterpreting advertising. You see, in high school, I had one thing on my mind, and that was basketball. What'd you guys think I was gonna say? Come on! You get a chance to wear those shorts? You think I'm gonna not wanna play basketball? No, I could play basketball. That was one thing I could do. I mean, I was small, but I was quick. I mean, I could run, I could shoot, and I could jump, clearly because of the shorts, right? I mean, all you young guys, you're envious. You wish you could wear those shorts in a basketball game, right? But no, I loved basketball. But you know, sadly, as high as I could jump, I could never do one thing. I could never dunk. I was vertically challenged. And so, you know, I was like, oh man, what am I never gonna be able to dunk? But then I came across the dream that I'd been waiting for, and I saw it, and it was the strength shoe. The answer to my dreams. There you go. Yeah, you guys remember that? The strength shoes. And you know what's funny is this is what the strength shoe advertised. It said, wearing these shoes when you're training can increase your jump height by between 5 and 10 inches. They can make you faster too. Wearing them could shave up to 2/10 of your 40-yard dash without any additional speed training when you run. Don't get left behind by competition for your playing time. Get stronger, run quicker, and jump higher with the strength shoes. Wow, I read that. But you know, for an 18-year-old, right, who always dreamed of dunking a basketball, how do you think I read that ad? I read it like this. Wearing these shoes when you're training will increase your jump height by between 5 and 10 inches. They will make you faster too. Wearing them will shave up to 2/10 of your 40-yard dash without any additional speed training when you run. So what do you think I did when I looked at that ad and I interpreted it that way? What do you think any reasonable, sane person would do? I went out and bought those shoes. As goofy as they looked and as expensive as they were, I bought them. And I wore them everywhere, guys. Even played basketball in them. And guess what they did for me? Absolutely nothing other than I rolled my ankles, I turned my knees, I got shin splints, but I never, ever could dunk a basketball. You can cry. That's okay. Go ahead. Give me the, oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, okay. That's all right. That's all right. I've accepted my lot in life, right? But you know, it's really sad. Sometimes we do the same with Scripture, don't we? I mean, we look at Scripture and we read into Scripture so much with our perspective and our desire that we miss the truth of Scripture sometimes. And one of the most misquoted and most misused verses of Scripture is found in Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And so for many of us, many people, when they look at that scripture and they hone in, they zero in on what? Those words, plans to prosper you. You see, we think, oh my goodness, plans to promise. That means that God's promise, I'm going to be powerful, I'm going to be prestigious, and man, I'm going to be popular, to include all the benefits of that, right? Rich, successful, money. Oh, plans to prosper you. But see, the danger with this, we know that, is that really what God is saying to us? And the danger is when we're not rich, we're not popular, when troubles come to us, when our health fails us, when our children's grades aren't what they should be, when we go to that job and interview and we don't get that job that we desperately want, and we go, God, how could you do this to me? It says in your scripture, you want to prosper me. And we begin to feel doubt. Maybe even we start to go, I don't know. God must be disappointed in me, and I'm disappointed in him. And we have division. We pull away from God. And so to correctly look at Scripture, we need to do with the proper lens of Scripture. And we cannot read into Scripture. We need to read out of it, the truth of God's word. And so the first question we can ask when we look at this great verse, this great promise of God, for I know the plans I have for you. We say, is this a promise for you or was it for someone else? And we can look back a few verses in Jeremiah 29 and we read that it was given to a specific group of people at a specific point of time. Reading in Jeremiah 29, 4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Now, a quick history lesson of the nation of Israel. Around 900 BC, shortly after King Solomon died, the nation of Israel split into two kingdoms. The northern kingdom, which was made up of 10 tribes, and that was called Israel, the kingdom of Israel. The southern kingdom was made up of the two remaining tribes, and that was the tribe or the kingdom of Judah. 10 and 2, Israel and Judah. Well, around 722 BC, the Assyrians came and they conquered the northern kingdom. They completely wiped out the entire kingdom, never to be heard from again. All 10 tribes gone. And around 600 BC, the Babylonians, they conquer the southern kingdom, Judah, and they take over the capital of Jerusalem. And as a result, approximately 3,000 Jews then are taken captive from Jerusalem and sent to Babylon. And so this is the context. This is the context of what Jeremiah, of who he is communicating to. He is communicating to these 3,000 exiles living in Babylon. And so the words in Jeremiah 29:11 were just a small part of some of the letters that Jeremiah had sent. Jeremiah was in Jerusalem, and he had sent some letters to the exiles living in Babylon. And so what else did God say? Let's look at a little broader view. Let's look at the full context, the verses surrounding Jeremiah 29:11. Let's look at Jeremiah 29:10 through 14. It says, this is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. God is promising, when the time is right, I will bring you back to Jerusalem and fulfill my promise. But 70 years are completed. Guys, 70 years. And we look at this promise and we think, God wants instant success for me, right? Guys, Jeremiah was speaking on behalf of the Lord. The Lord said, 70 years. How long is 70 years? Some of you are 70 years old. But just to give us a little better context, 70 years ago, World War II had just ended. That's a long time, guys, right? That's a long time to be in exile. And also, God's going to bring them back to Jerusalem, fulfilling his promise. And he says at that time, or then, that God promised that he was going to restore the nation. He was going to restore that kingdom. So why did God say it? Why did God say these verses? Why did he speak through the prophet Jeremiah? He did it because first, it was given to people who had rebelled and now faced exile. You see, they were living outside of God's covenant with them. A covenant which had been established 800 years earlier. 800 years earlier in Moses. Do you remember that time? Go all the way back to Deuteronomy 4, and that's where God had established this covenant, this binding agreement between God and the people of Israel, with all of its benefits and blessings, but also responsibilities, and what happens when you don't follow the covenant. Read in Deuteronomy 4, we realize that that covenant says that you can live in the promised land, as long as you obey my laws, my decrees, and follow me. That was the conditions of the covenant. And when you go back and read the early chapters of Jeremiah, Jeremiah was warning the people that they were not living within the construct of the confines of that covenant. Instead, what they had done is they had forsaken God, and they were actually pursuing false idols. They were living outside of the framework of the covenant. And so judgment came, God's judgment, and they were sent into exile. And we also know that this promise was given to counter previous claims by false prophets. You see, what had happened was Jeremiah had been warning them, and then when it happened, Jeremiah said, here's what God's saying, 70 years. And along came some false prophets, and one of them was a guy named Hananiah. And if you flip back a couple of pages in your Bible, you'll see chapter 28. It's all about this kind of communication, this exchange between Jeremiah and this false prophet named Hananiah. Now, what was Hananiah saying? Hananiah was saying, don't believe Jeremiah. It's not going to be that long. It's only going to be a couple of years. In fact, 2 years is what it's going to be, because God's going to bring you back to power and restore you. So don't believe Jeremiah. You see, he was telling the people what they wanted to hear. He wasn't telling them what they needed to hear, the truth of God's word. And Jeremiah was. And so Jeremiah's letter really was a way to warn the exiles against the deception of this false prophet and others. It was also given to assure the people of the restoration of their nation, not for them, but for future generations. Think about it. Those who were reading the letter, they would never probably get the opportunity to see the promised land. That was the reality. Either them or their children, because 70 years would elapse, 3 or 4 generations before they would see the fulfillment of God's faithful promise. And if you go back and read, you go back and look in the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, you read that around 537, the promise was fulfilled. Those exiles returned, many of the exiles, second, third, fourth generation, returned to the promised land. God's promise fulfilled 70 years later. And so with that proper context, when we look at that one verse, what does it actually mean? What does it mean to us? I think it means first that despite their present circumstances, God had not forgotten his people or his covenant with them. God is faithful. Said God's words to the exiles through Jeremiah, it was a lot less about like motivating them to this desirable status in life. It was actually meant to really inspire them to trust him despite the despicable and desperate circumstances in their life. Trust him. And also God's plans called for peace and salvation, not prosperity, prestige, and power. And so the word prosper, we can go back and look at Jeremiah 27. We can see it used again and again, prosper. But what does that verse really mean? The Hebrew text for that is the word shalom. Shalom. And what that verse really means and what the context is, it doesn't refer to money or material blessings. Not in the kind of context that we read into it, right? It actually refers to physical and spiritual salvation. This idea of being delivered from danger or suffering and being restored to wholeness. Salvation, restoration, wholeness. That's what God was talking about. And with that, you get peace and strength. Salvation, restoration, wholeness, peace and strength. So it carries a lot more meaning with it, doesn't it? Than just being popular and powerful and having lots of money, right? Shalom. And we also know that a hopeful end was in God's plan. But it was going to be in his time and not as soon as the people would want. And we read in that terms, those terms, hope and a future. Hope and future. The context there is a hopeful end. And even though the people couldn't see the end, they needed to trust God, that God in the end, beyond the horizon, that God had a plan in place. Their hopeful end beyond the horizon. That's the context, hope and a future. And so then what can we learn from this Old Testament text? What do we today, living today, what do we learn from this Old Testament text? And what eternal truths do we see when we read this? The first eternal truth is God is faithful to his promises. God is faithful to his promises. And just as he was faithful, just as he was faithful to his promises of the nation of Judah, he's faithful to us. Amen. Aren't you so glad that we serve a faithful God? Amen. Amen. We also know that God has a plan and a purpose. And just as God had a plan and a purpose for the nation of Judah, in spite of their circumstances, in spite of everything around them, God also has a plan and a purpose for our lives and for us. Despite what we might be going through today, God has a plan and a purpose. And I reflect back on my father-in-law, who was my spiritual mentor. My father-in-law, Tony, used to remind me, he used to always say that God's ways are higher than our ways. He pulled that from scripture. He didn't make that up. And he also said his plans are greater than we can imagine, and his purpose is beyond our understanding and comprehension. And Tony used to always say to me too, and he'd remind us all, and he'd say, if you want to make God laugh, just tell him your plans. That was my father-in-law. He was a great, great, great presence in my life. And we know this third thing is that God's presence brings peace and his promises give hope. God's presence brings peace and his promises give us hope. And just as God's presence brought shalom, this salvation, this restoration, this idea of wholeness, God also gives us the same peace in his presence and in his promise. And so what does it mean today? What does it mean to us today? What are some kind of lessons we can pull from Jeremiah 29:11 and the context with which that verse falls? Number one, rebellion against God still has serious consequences. But God, he's made a way to redeem us. So for the nation of Israel, rebellion led to what? 70 years of exile, right? 70 years of exile from the promised land. For us, rebellion leads to eternal separation from God. Eternal separation from God. And that rebellion is called sin. And we know that the Bible says that the judgment or the punishment for sin is death and eternal separation from God. But our loving and merciful and faithful Heavenly Father, he had a plan. And we read about that beginning, and actually in Psalm 111, verse 9, we can see a small sample of that plan. It says, he provided, which means he sent. He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. And this verse tells us that God sent redemption to us, to his people. And his covenant is forever promised forever. That's like a double forever, right? Amen? God's covenant forever. And so just as God was both faithful and merciful to the exiles, and he brought them out of captivity, and he restored them as a nation, God wants to do the same for us. And so what did he do? He made a way to do the same for us. To redeem us, to bring us out of captivity, out of bondage to sin, to release us or cover us from the judgment of that sin, and to restore us into right relationship with him. And since we can never do this on our own, what did he do? He sent redemption to us, fulfilling all of his promises. And so we know that Jesus is the fulfillment of all God has promised. Jesus is the fulfillment of all God has promised. Jesus, Emmanuel, which means God is with us. The fulfillment of all God's promises. Jesus is like this hinge of history when all of God's promises in the past, all of those scriptures from Old Testament, all of the promises, they're all fulfilled in Christ, and the promises of the present and the promises of the future to infinity and beyond. God fulfilled in Jesus Christ, the hinge of history. And still today, we look at history, and it's all Jesus is the hinge. Jesus fulfilled all that God promised. Redemption. In Ephesians 1:7, we read that Jesus is the fulfillment of redemption and forgiveness of sins. It says, Ephesians 1:7, in him we have redemption through his blood. The forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. See, Jesus, his shed blood on the cross, it paid the price for us. It paid the price for all our sins, all the sins of the past, all the sins of the present, and all the sins of the future, once and for all. Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of Scripture, redeem forgiveness. And we also know that Jesus is the fulfillment, and we read about this in verses of the Bible all through Scripture. There's a group of verses in Titus 3, 4 through 7. It's a beautiful set of verses that remind us of these promises fulfilled in Jesus Christ. We read, but when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things that we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Wow. Let me just summarize that real quickly. It says that we are saved from the penalty of death. It says that we are forgiven of our sins. We are freed from the bondage of sin. We are made right before God, justified. We're made right before God. We're filled by the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. We're adopted as a child of the living God. And because of that, we are made a co-heir with Christ. A co-heir, inheriting all of the blessings, privileges, and promises of Jesus Christ. And we have the hope and assurance of eternal life. Can I get an amen, church? Amen. Powerful. God's promises fulfilled in Jesus Christ. So I have a question. Have you believed the promises of the promised one, Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of Scripture, Old Testament, all of those promises? Have you believed in his promise? And have you placed your faith in Jesus Christ? And even if you have, today, in the middle of your circumstances you're going through, would you just say, Lord, I want to just trust in those promises. I want to claim these promises. I want to live in those promises. Jesus Christ, fulfillment of all God's promises. And number three, third lesson. Jesus alone offers peace and strength in the face of trials and times of adversity. Think about that. Jesus Christ, he offers us peace and strength. Jesus offers us shalom. Just as God offered to the exiles, Jesus offers the same. Some of Jesus' final words to his disciples before Jesus would go to the cross, and Jesus knew what they were going to be facing. Jesus spoke these words in John 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. In Christ, peace. In the world, troubles. And Jesus said, you will have troubles. Not you might have troubles. So Jesus gives us the peace. In Jesus, we find the peace that gives us both rest and restoration. and courage and confidence. It doesn't matter what our circumstances are, we can find that peace in Christ. It's that peace that Pastor Dennis talked about last week. Peace of Christ. In Jesus, we can also find the strength to be content in every situation. Reading the words of the Apostle Paul, he wrote to the Philippian church in Philippians 4, verses 12 through 13. Philippians 4, 13 is another popular verse that people like to misquote and misuse. Reading those verses, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, I can do all this through him, through Christ, who gives me strength. And the original language of that verse 13 really says, I have strength for all things. Why? Because Jesus. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying. Strength and being content. And so how can we find that peace and strength? How can we find that when we're facing times of trial and adversity? How can we find that? Well, we can do that by leaning into those promises of Jesus, leaning into Christ. We spend time in prayer, getting down on our knees or wherever we may be to lift up prayer to him. Prayers of hope, prayers of praise, prayers of anguish. No matter where we're at, spend time in prayer. We also can spend time in God's word because we know what happens. What happens when we go through trials and we go through adversity and we go through times when we are just desperate, kind of like the video you heard earlier. What happens? The enemy comes, doesn't he? He seeks to devour. He wants to destroy. He'll try to lie. He'll try to twist scripture. And when you're wounded and when you're weak and when you're isolated, the enemy comes. And we want to go right to the power of God's word. Get into the word, the truth of God's word. Prayer. Seek his word. Seek him. And finally, we also can spend time sharing in fellowship with other believers, right? We can encourage one another. We can pray with one another. Share our burdens together. That's where we can find the peace and strength of Christ. Simple ways to do that. And so is there a circumstance or a situation in your life right now that you're facing where you desperately need the peace and strength of Christ? I would encourage you to look and to lean into Christ, to look into these different ways to do that. Prayer, God's word, community. And we can also find hope and assurance, right? We can find hope and assurance in situations and times when we absolutely have just nothing but doubt and despair. We can find hope and assurance because ultimately, our hope and future rests in Jesus and on his promise. Amen? His promise. And what did he promise? 1 John 2:25. And this is what he promised us. Eternal life. Our hopeful end, our hope in a future, eternity, eternal life with God. That's our hopeful end. And since we're eternally secure, and we know that Jesus is with us, he's present with us in our times of struggle, in our times of doubt, we know that we can have an eternal perspective. If we know our destination is secure, we can have that eternal perspective. And that gives us hope and assurance and confidence to make it through the next day. And not only to do that, but to do it with joy. And as Paul said, contentment. And so as I close, I want to go back to that story. That story is very important to me because for many of you know, the lady that was in that video is also my bride of 34 years. And so throughout that time, I was in Afghanistan and I was struggling. I had no idea. I questioned. I was like, God, why am I here? And my family's falling apart. Lord, I can't do this anymore. And just as Amy said in the video where she was leaning into God and leaning into his promises, I was in Afghanistan doing the same thing on my face before the Lord, saying, Lord, give me the peace, give me the strength, because I can't do it. But we serve a faithful and loving, merciful God. And in that time, my faith grew stronger as I leaned on him. And Amy's faith grew stronger as she leaned on him. And after 30 years of being in school and being away from school and raising a family, Amy finally got her college degree and fulfilled her childhood dream of becoming a school teacher 30 years later. And that son, our son, ended up having another ACL reconstruction. That means a knee. He trashed his other knee. But he would end up going and playing college football. 4 years of college football, graduate from college, and most importantly, he loves Jesus. And her father, who we lost, I was present. I had the opportunity to come back and present the flag to my mother-in-law in thanks and appreciation for his service to our country. He left a legacy, multiple generations, not only in his family, but in all kinds of other families. And that precious little baby girl that Amy talked about miraculously survived. And in June of 2011, after 15 months in Afghanistan, I had the opportunity to hold her for the first time. And here's a picture. And just this last Friday, that precious little baby who God had in the palm of his hands, she celebrated her 6th birthday. Amen. Amen. God is faithful. And I don't know why our family had to go through that. That's just one sample. Your family, I know today, you might be going through something similar. But please hear us. Hear me on this. God has a plan. Plan to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we've come to you today, Father, as a merciful, faithful, loving Heavenly Father. And Father, we say thank you for your promises fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And Lord, today we know in a group of this size, whether they're here in the worship center, whether online or whether they're in the family worship venue, that there are some that don't yet know you, Lord Jesus, as their personal Lord and Savior. So Lord Jesus, we pray today that if you've spoken and you're speaking to them now, that they would grab that, they would latch on to that, and that they would move in the steps to place their faith in you, Jesus. And for oh so many others, Lord, today, thank you for reminding us of your promise fulfilled in Christ. And may we move from here today, Lord, grabbing and understanding and living out those promises and trusting in you for your plan and your purpose in our lives. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.